Hello friends, let's discuss about the classifications of organisms. Classifications. Why we should study classifications? What is the need of the classification? The classification is needed to study the diversity of the life forms. The life which is present on the earth, it has a tremendous diversity. We know different types of organisms are present here. They range from small microscopic bacteria, unicellular, prokaryotic bacteria, to the eukaryotic organisms like the blue whales, the giant animals, or some great banyan like trees. The trees which are made up of trillions of cells together. At one hand, there are organisms which are minute, which are microscopic, which are unicellular. At the same time, there are organisms which are tremendous in their size. The Chlamydomonas, single cell animal, single cell plants, and at the same time, there are the trees like sequoia or banyan tree. They range, they differ, they vary in their size, in their shape, in their body designs, in their behavior patterns, in their feeding habitats. So all the animals, all the plants, all the organisms which are present on the earth today show a great diversity. Now this bewildering variety of life around us, it has been evolved over millions of years. And we want to study them in a fraction of time. What is our life? If we consider the geological time scale, if we consider the period of evolution of the life around us, then our life is just a fraction of the time. And we want to know, we want to study the whole diversity, whole diverse forms of organisms in this fraction of time. Is it possible to study them separately? No. It is highly impossible, it is virtually impossible to study these organisms one by one separately. But there is a way. We can study them if we arrange them systematically in the classes or the groups. And then we study them as the groups or groups as the whole. If we arrange them systematically, means if we classify them, then we can study them. The diverse forms of life can be studied with the help of classification, and that is the need of classification. The grouping of organisms or systematic arrangement of organisms is classification. So this figure shows the diversity. We have taken only few organisms here. At one corner you see the organisms like the bacteria, amoeba, paramecia, all these are the unicellular organisms. They are microscopic organisms, they are either prokaryotic or eukaryotic, but they are the minute and microscopic organisms. So we have to measure them in millimicrons or micrometers, nanometers, their size. And at the same time, you can see this tree. It is a banyan tree, or you can see this tree. It is a sequoia plant. You can see the blue whale. What giant organisms are these? At the same time, they are differing in their size. They also differ in their lifespan. These microorganisms may have the life of 1 day or 2 days or only few days. But at the same time, you know there are certain trees which grow continuously for 1,000 years. Their age is 1,000 years. So the lifespan is also differing. This is just a glimpse how the organisms are diverse. There are algae in plants, there are other plants, biophyte, pteridophyte, gymnosperms and angiosperms, plant forms, in animals, insects. It is a big class of insects. Then other animals are also there. The reptiles are there, birds are there, amphibians are there, other mammals are there. These viruses and bacteria, they are also the different kind of organisms. So this depicts how the diversity is present among the organisms. The life forms show a great diversity. Now, to study this diversity, we have to classify these organisms. We have to put the organisms into groups and subgroups. So, what is classification then? Classification is defined as a grouping of organisms on the basis of similarities and differences. It is a grouping of living forms on the basis of similarities and differences. We have to find out what similar characters are there, what differences are there, and on that basis we put them into different classes, into different groups, into different divisions. Classification is the systematic arrangement of organisms into groups and subgroups. Classification is the systematic arrangement. It is the science of systematics, and therefore it is a branch in the taxonomy. Classification comes in the taxonomy. We know taxonomy is defined as the branch of biology which deals with identification, nomenclature, and classification. So this taxonomy includes the classification. Taxonomy deals with the diversity, forms, and evolutionary relationship among the organisms. It deals with the diversity, it deals with the forms, and it deals with the evolutionary relationship among the organisms. Taxonomy, according to Ernst Mayr, is the theory and practice of classifying the organisms. Theory and practice. Now, the classifications, they are based on certain characters and characteristics. Attempts at classifying organisms into groups have been made since time immemorial. There is a continuous try to classify the organisms, time to time. Early attempts of classification of organisms were made by Greek thinkers like Aristotle. His student Theophrastus, Pliny the Elder, like that. Majority of the work was done by the Greek people initially. So, in classification also, initial work was done by these Greek people. The characteristics used as the basis of classification changed time to time. The base for classification is the characters, especially morphological characters initially. So, the characteristics which were considered by Aristotle or Theophrastus for classification are not considered now. The characters have been changed. Initially, the people used very few and only few characters for classifying. These characters were easily observable. Aristotle or Theophrastus was not having well-equipped laboratories to study the organisms. They were not having the microscopes. They were not having other instruments. And they just wandered in the forest or in the bio ecosystems, and they observed the organisms, and on that basis, on the basis of some external observable characters, they tried to classify the organisms, and therefore the classifications given by them certainly differ. The base of classification, the basic characters of classification has been changed time to time. Characteristics which were considered in earlier days have been changed now. In the early days, only few easily observable characters were used by taxonomists to classify the organisms. But now we consider many interrelated characters. Now we know that we have to consider cytological characters, we have to consider anatomical characters, we have to consider embryological characters, we go for pollen morphology, and all these characters, so many other characters we have to consider while classifying the organism. So, the basic characteristics used for classification in the earlier days were different, and now they have been different. Now, depending on the characters used as the basis of classifications time to time, the overall classification systems have been divided into three categories. Whatever classifications have been given by scientists or taxonomists up to date, all of them are put into three categories. They are the artificial classifications, natural classifications, and phylogenetic classifications. Now, let's see what are the artificial classifications. Artificial classifications are the classifications which were given in the early stage when the studies of life sciences began. Aristotle, Theophrastus, Linnaeus, they gave such type of classifications. When the organisms were classified for the sake of convenience using some easily observable characters, just I said, the laboratories were well equipped, the laboratories were not present at that time, they lack the microscopes, any type of microscopes were absent. So at that time, some easily observable characters were considered as the base for classifications, and such classifications are called as artificial. Whatever grouping was done at that time, it was irrespective of the affinities. Suppose there is a group made by Aristotle. Aristotle classified all the animals into three groups. He gave a classification for animals. So, he classified the animals on the basis of their habitat. Land animals, aquatic animals, arboreal animals. The animals which fly or which are living above the land. They are arboreal, either in the trees or in the sky. Some animals which are living on the land, they are terrestrial animals or land animals, and other animals which live in the water, they are aquatic animals. So, these are the three groups made by Aristotle. Now, see, land animals. We know variety of millions of animals are present on the land. There are insects, there are reptiles, there are amphibians, there are other animals like the mammals, so many. Gorillas and chimpanzees are there, frog is also there, so many, the centipede is there. So, they are different, they are not having any common characters. Just habitat is common, their habitat is common, but they are not sharing some common characters. There is no set of characters which is shared by them. And when we call this group as artificial, because this group contains such animals which are not having natural affinities. So, the word artificial comes in context with the affinities. They are not having natural affinities. They have been put together in one group, but they are not having natural affinities. Early systems of plant classifications were mostly artificial. Only few characters were considered for grouping of these organisms. There is one famous system given by Linnaeus, father of taxonomy. For example, on the basis of single character, and that is number of stamens, he gave a system, Linnaeus, Carolus Linnaeus. His system is named as sexual system because it considers the androecium, number of stamens. He classified whatever known flowering plants into 24 classes and named them as the classes, 24 classes. Begins with monandria, dianthria, triandria, tetraandria, pentandria, hexandria, heptandria, nanandria, octandria, nanandria, decandria, like that, 24 classes. Basic character is number of stamens. Just one character is used for classification. Now see what happens. In this classification, Canna and Salicornia both come to the same group because they are having a single genus, a single stamen. So, Canna comes from Canaceae, and Canaceae is a monocot family. Salicornia comes from Chenopodiaceae, it comes from dicot. So, one monocot plant comes with a dicot plant. Both are placed together in monandria because they are having a single stamen. Now, do they share affinity? Do they have natural affinity? No, not at all. Because one is monocot plant, the monocots are reticule, parallel venation monocots are single cotyledon, monocots show adventitious root system, dicots differ in all these things. So salicornia is a dicot plant, canna is a monocot plant, monocot genus, and both are placed together in monandra. So this happens. This type of grouping is called as artificial grouping. Though the organisms do not share natural affinity, they have been put together. And that's why these classifications which are given in the early days were considered as artificial classifications. Now come to the natural classifications. When the science advanced, science of classifications, the taxonomists come to know that artificial classification is not a proper way to group the organisms, and then they moved to the natural classifications. Now in natural classifications, all the possible characters have been considered together. Each and every possible character is considered at the time of grouping. All the similarities and dissimilarities were studied. It is now known to all of us that you, as per evolution theory, all the plants existing today, they are related to each other. They have been evolved from one another, and therefore in classifications, the closely related plants should be grouped together, or the closely related organisms should be grouped together. They should not be placed far apart from one another. This is practiced in natural classifications. What is practiced? The closeness, natural affinities. There is concentration in these classifications on the natural affinities. When we create a group, the members of that group should show some set of characters which are common in them. More similarities should be there and less differences should be there. Later pre-Darwinian systems of plant classification have mostly attempted to be natural. Pre-Darwinian, they tried to be natural in the sense that they are based upon all resemblances, mostly in cross morphology. Now, natural classifications are mostly based on morphology. So, in case of the morphology, all the possible characters, set of characters for each organism is decided, and then depending on the similarities and differences, the organisms are grouped. So, classification tends to be natural. There are natural affinities. When we call it a Malvoisie family in Bentham and Hooker's classification, it is a family which includes the hibiscus, which includes Malva genus, which includes Gossypium, and we can see that all of them have near about similar morphology. So the classifications tended to be natural because the grouping was based on natural affinities. It is presumed that larger the number of characters shared by different taxa, more closely are they related to each other, and therefore in the beginning I said more and more characters were considered. Maximum characters were traced out to group these organisms. This formed the basis of modern classifications. Natural classifications formed the basis for modern classifications. The information needed for arriving at a satisfactory natural classification is now gathered from various sources or disciplines of science. As I told, we now go for the palynology, we now go for the cytology, we now go for the genetics, so many aspects. Morphology of the chromosomes, karyotype, we study the ideogram, and then we decide which organisms are closer to which organism. So these natural classifications gave the basement for the modern classifications. And actually, the modern classifications are phylogenetic classification. Natural classifications founded the base, foundation, but the most modern classifications are actually the phylogenetic classification. They have been replaced. The natural classifications have been replaced by phylogenetic classifications. Now, what are the phylogenetic classification? What is phylogeny? Phylogeny means the evolutionary relationship. Now, I would give one example. Gorillas and chimpanzees, the ape monkeys, they are placed together with human beings. We are the primates, human beings, gorillas and chimpanzees and orangutans. All of us are primates in one group. Why we are not similar morphologically? They are quite big with so many hairs on their body. They are quite, the face is different than us. Their waves are different from us. Their habitat is different. They still live in the trees. They are arboreal mostly, and we are living in the houses and cities. But even then, we are placed together. Now, morphologically, we are not alike. So, we are not placed together on the basis of natural classification. We are placed together on the basis of phylogeny. Phylogenetically, we are related. We both have common ancestors. Our ancestry is common. The orangutan, gorilla and chimpanzee have the same ancestry like the human beings. Just they have been bifurcated from the line of evolution and they formed a parallel line of evolution, and therefore they are very close to us as compared to other organisms. So, post-Darwinian systems of classification are mostly claimed to be phylogenetic, and phylogeny is the evolutionary relationship. The classifications are aimed at finding out the evolutionary relationship. Phylogeny is defined as the evolutionary relationship between different organisms. The natural classifications are often termed as horizontal, because when we classify the organisms in natural classification, we try to consider all the characters at one time. Suppose Bentham and Hooker gave a system, then Bentham and Hooker studied the plants at that time, at one particular time, for 3 years, 4 years, 5 years, 10 years, and they gave the system. So, they considered the characters of a particular period at a particular time, and therefore these classifications are horizontal classifications. But the phylogenetic classifications are vertical classifications. The phylogenetic classifications are based on known or inferred phylogeny of the taxa. Here we go for the evolutionary history, who evolved, who gave rise to which group. And in this way, a phylogenetic tree is designed based on the knowledge of the fossils, based on the phylogeny. Presumed evolutionary trend is traced out, and on that basis, the classification is done. So, this classification includes a tree diagram. In this tree diagram, we start towards the base where the primitive groups are there, and when we advances towards the top of the tree, the more and more evolved groups are placed. When we reach the tip of the tree, it is the most evolved group at the tip. So, these diagrams which are represented in the phylogenetic classifications, they show the vertical classification. This classification, phylogenetic classifications, are known as vertical classifications because these are the classifications in which the knowledge of millions of years have been considered together. It is based on the characters from the history also, from the evolution also. It is not based on the characters at one time. It is based on the characters for millions of years together, and therefore these classifications are the vertical classifications. The term is vertical for them. So, these are the three types of classifications. The linear system is the example of linear, and sexual system is the example of the artificial classification. Bentham and Hooker system is the example of natural classification, and the phylogenetic classifications are given by many modern botanists like our Takhtajan, conquest, or even they were started by Engler and Prandtl. But Engler and Prandtl system is considered as a transitional phylogeny because it does not reflect a clear-cut phylogeny. But even then, it is the beginning of phylogenetic classification. So in this way, here, I think we should stop today. Thank you very much.